So you can read here what you have to do. If you need to print, please print only if strictly necessary because it costs us, okay? So you need to send an email to printing@ictp.it with the poster in a PDF form attached, stating the format, okay, I don't know, A2, A1, whatever, I don't know. It's the format of your poster. And add the sentence, cost to be charged to summer school, SMR 3235. You should send this at latest, by Monday, because Wednesday is the poster session. So if you, if you send it on Wednesday or on Tuesday, it's not guaranteed that you will gonna get your poster. If you have a poster printed already, I will tell you, so the issue is the following. I would like to have the poster session up on the terrace, where we also will have wine and cheese, but the weather forecast is uncertain. Okay, so we're waiting until the last minute to see whether we will have it on the terrace or here, because there are poster boards all around this room. I would, of course, prefer to do it on the terrace, but we cannot commit by now. So I'm going to tell you where to put the posters on Monday. Any questions regarding this? Everybody who has sent an abstract is accepted, by the way. So. There are no crazy people among you. I was afraid somebody would present a poster like the theory of everything. I can explain why E is equal MC squared using cellular automata. Yes. You had a question? No? No question? Okay, very good. So if there are no questions, then I leave the microphone to Professor Dalibard, and here we go.
Like this. Oops, thank you.
Can you erase this later on?
No, I think I will have enough space, I hope. Okay, welcome back, everybody. So let us continue with what I call the first lecture of this series of two. So I remind you where we were just before lunch. We were asking ourselves, how can we describe an interacting 2D Bose gas? And I was proposing to use a classical field analysis, which means that I am assuming that all my particles share the same wave function, which I called little psi of xy. I have frozen the vertical motion, the motion along z, so the real wave function in the 3D space is this psi of xy times a fixed wave function along z, which is just the ground state of the harmonic oscillator confining the particle along z. And I explained to you that the energy functional of this classical field is a so-called Gross-Pitayevsky functional. It involves two terms. The first one is the kinetic energy term, which is proportional to grad psi modulus square integrated over the whole space, xy. And the second term is a psi 4 term, and it results from describing the interactions between particles as a contact term, a Dirac distribution. Particles interact only if they are on the same point. And the factor in front of this interaction energy term, the one which characterizes the strength of the energy, is a dimensionless coefficient, which I denoted g tilde. And if I want to connect g tilde to real life, the g tilde actually is a ratio of two lengths within a factor square root of 8 pi. On the numerator, I have the 3D scattering lengths, which characterize how do particles interact in 3D. And in the denominator, I have something which is the thickness of the gas, so to speak. This is the size of the ground state of the harmonic oscillator along z. But you don't need to know A and AOH separately to describe your 2D Bose gas. The only thing you need to know is the value of g tilde. And as I told you, g tilde is typically between 0.1 and 1. And to say it briefly, 0.1 means a weakly interacting gas, whereas above 1, this is a strongly interacting gas. But this will become clearer later and probably tomorrow. Okay, so as I tried to explain you just before lunch, although we are doing a classical field analysis, we are not getting rid of all quantum physics, and there is still something which is quantized, which is the circulation of the velocity, because the velocity is simply h bar over n times the gradient of the phase of my classical field. I would like to start this second part of the lecture by showing you that indeed I still have some quantum features, so to speak, into this classical field approach. But now I would like to look at something different, which is the Bose-Einstein law, the one which is still written on the board here. And I would like to convince you that the Bose-Einstein law contains this classical field analysis. And for that, I would like to come back to a simple way to justify the Bose-Einstein law. I mean, if you are on a desert island and you have to explain to rederive the Bose-Einstein law, how can you do it in two lines? So first, let's derive the Boltzmann law. And for that, I just look at the collision processes that can occur in a gas if I have a gas at equilibrium. So I can have two incident particles with some energy associated to the state G1 and energy associated to G2, so E1 and E2, a collision between the partners, and I get G3 and G4, okay? And so I have a collision, G1 plus G2 gives G3 plus G4, if E1 plus E2 is equal to E3 plus E4. And of course, the inverse process is also possible, that is, I can play the movie back, and have G3 plus G4 gives G1 plus G2. And if I am at equilibrium, I have a detailed balance condition, which tells me, classically, that this process has the same rate as that one, therefore NJ1, NJ2 has to be equal to NJ3, NJ4, as soon as I take the four energies such that. And if I assume, which is valid at, for our system, that NJ, the population of a state J, depends only on its energy, EJ, this means that the function N of E must be such that NE1, NE2 equal NE3, NE4. So I don't know whether you know how to prove that. This means that, and this, the only function that allows this to be satisfied for any quadruplet of energy E1, E2, E3, E4 is a function which is an exponential of the energy. So let me simply prove that. So I'm telling you that I have NE1, NE2 equal NE3, NE4 as soon as E1 plus E2 equal E3 plus E4. So let me call f of e the log of n of e. And then the function f of e, when I take the log of this, should be such that for any quadruplet E1, E2, E3, E4, satisfying E1 plus E2 equal E3 plus E4, then the function itself should be such that f of E1 plus f of E2 equal f of E3 plus f of E4. And it's very easy to show, this I will not do it, but it's simple math, to show that the only type of function which satisfies this when I have this relation between the energies are the function f of e of the type which are linear in e plus some constant b. These are the only one. And again, it's really not complicated to show. So if f of e is like that, then N of E, which is the exponential F, is like exponential A of E plus B, and this is nothing but the Boltzmann distribution, okay? So it's a simple way to redivide Boltzmann distribution. What about Bose-Einstein law? Then you have to remember that when you are dealing with quantum particles, you don't have only collisions like I described, but you have actually stimulated emission process. The collision like I described, E1, E2 gives E3, E4, and therefore NE1, NE2 equal NE3, NE4, correspond to spontaneous emission. That is, I have two particles colliding in 1 and 2, and I can go into the final state, 3 and 4, and it was not stimulated. But if now I am dealing with bosons, I have some stimulated emission which is possible, which means that when I have 1 and 2 which are colliding, the rate at which I can produce 3 and 4 can be stimulated if I already have some particle in 3 and some particle in 4. Okay, I have some enhancement if I'm dealing with bosons, if 3 and 4 is already populated. And as you know, this enhancement is simply 1 plus n, the stimulated emission term. So the process 1 plus 2 gives 3 plus 4, as it occurs actually with the rate, if I have stimulated emission, n1, n2, the occupation of the initial state, 1 plus n3, 1 plus n4. And this has to be equal, again, to the reverse process. 3 plus 4 gives 1 plus 2. So N3, N4, the occupation of the initial state for the reverse process, times 1 plus N1, 1 plus N2. OK, so what are the functions which satisfy this? It seems a bit complicated, but actually it's not. I just have to take this 1 plus NG1 and put it in the denominator here. Same thing for 1 plus NG2. Same thing for 1 plus NG3 and therefore, and so on. And now I'm left again with a function of E1 times a function of E2 has to be equal to the product of the function of E3 plus the function of E4. So it's exactly the same type of relation as here, except that instead of N, I have N over 1 plus N. So again, same thing. N over 1 plus N has to be the exponential of a linear function, exponential of A, E plus B. And this is now it's a simple algebra to show that this N of E, therefore, is equal to 1 over something exponential minus AE plus B minus 1. And this is nothing but the Bose-Einstein statistics. Okay, so this is a few lines way of recovering Bose-Einstein statistics if you understand that in a collision process, you have not only spontaneous emission, but you have stimulated emission. So spontaneous emission is this one, stimulated emission is this N. Okay? Any question at this stage? No? Okay, so now if I try to look at this Bose-Einstein law and understand what are the two extreme regimes of this law, that is the high energy regime and the low energy regime. The high energy regime is what allows you to recover from Bose-Einstein, Maxwell-Boltzmann. If I take, say that the energy is very large here in the denominator, the exponential of E over KT is very large, so I can forget about the minus one, and then I recover N of E equal exponential mu minus E over KT. This is the regime of classical particles, Maxwell-Boltzmann. So this is the true Bose-Einstein law is in black, and Maxwell-Boltzmann is the dotted blue line that you have here. Now, if you take the opposite regime, the regime of low energies, and I remind you, this is the regime in which we are interested for BKT physics, because I'm looking at large wavelengths, so small wave vectors, small energy. Then, in this expression here, the energy and mu are very small compared to KT, so I can linearize this exponential, and I get then something which is simply KT over U divided by E minus mu, which is very large compared to 1, by hypothesis here. And then I recover a population proportional to T, which was what I got just before lunch for a classical field. I told you that for a classical field, the average of the modulus square of the amplitude of a mode was proportional to KT, so this is what I recover here. So I recover the regime of classical field with occupation number very large compared to 1. So when I say, when you say, let's take the classical limit of a Bose-Einstein law, it doesn't mean much. I mean, the two extreme regimes are classical. This regime here is classical in the sense that you neglect stimulated emission, you keep only spontaneous emission, and then you have a classical regime with respect to particles. Whereas if you look at what is happening here, you neglect spontaneous emission in front of stimulated emission, and then you have a classical regime in terms of field. So the Bose-Einstein law actually is a way to connect these two, so to speak, classical regime, a regime which is particle-dominated here, and here a regime which is field-dominated. And the Bose-Einstein law actually takes into account both the particle and the field nature of the matter. Okay? So again, this classical regime that I'm going to use contains some quantum feature. It contains this limit of the Bose-Einstein law, the low-energy limit. Any question at this stage? No? Okay, so maybe I can skip that, which is just another way of stating what I said. And so let's go back to this 2D Gross-Pitayevsky energy functional, and let's try to see what we can say about it. So I remind you what we have, kinetic energy, grad psi square, interaction energy, psi 4. And the wave function is normalized, such the integral over whole space is equal to the number of particles they've put in the system. I had some questions during the break about that. What I'm really looking at here is a kind of canonical ensemble. I fixed the number of particles, but I impose some temperature from the outside because I'm supposing that I'm interacting with some energy reservoir. Okay, so the first thing I would like to mention about the analysis of this energy functional is that when we are at very low temperature, or if you prefer, when we are at large density, so what I mean is a large, actually, phase space density, product of rho times lambda square, which is rho over temperature, because lambda is square root of T, so large rho over T, then the density fluctuations are suppressed. And this is relatively easy to understand. Let's take simply a ground, the box of size L times L, a square box, and let's look at the ground state of this box. So I start at T equals zero. Then if I take a square box and I look at zero energy, if I take periodic boundary condition, then the ground state is just a uniform gas, okay? No kinetic energy and no density fluctuation. So psi of r is simply square root of the density with a phase equal to one by phase equal to zero by convention, so no e to the I theta. This density is simply the number of particles divided by L square, so the area of the box, and the interaction energy is therefore h bar square over 2m, this g tilde and the product rho zero times n. So now let's go to non-zero temperature. What I claim is that if I am at relatively large phase space density, then the density fluctuation will be very small, and I can neglect them in first approximation. Here I have plotted this modulus of psi as a function of xy, and what I'm saying is that the modulus of psi is nearly constant, and the reason for that is that if I take a large phase space density, so rho zero times lambda square, very large compared to one, then density fluctuation have a very high energy cost. I take the interaction energy, which is written here, I calculate it per particle, so I divide by capital N, and when I take this quantity, h bar square over 2m g tilde rho zero, and I compare it to kBT, you see that what I see appearing is simply this h bar square over 2m divided by kBT, which is nothing but lambda square here, h bar square divided by m kBT, times the density, rho tilde, rho zero. So what I get in the end with g tilde is g tilde times the phase space density divided by 4 pi. And if I take the limit of large phase space density d, then it means that this is very large compared to one. So the interaction energy per particle is very large compared to kT. So it costs a lot to create a significant density fluctuation. Okay, the particles are repelling themselves so strongly that I would prefer to have a uniform density. Of course, I will be left with phase fluctuation, but the density fluctuation are very strongly reduced at large phase space density. So I concentrate now on phase fluctuations. So let's look at the energy related to phase fluctuation. So the interaction energy now is frozen because the interaction energy is just a modulus of psi to the 4, so the phase does not enter into the interaction energy. So the only thing which will remain is kinetic energy. This kinetic energy is therefore the gradient of psi, and if I plug the fact that psi is the square root of density times e to the I theta, and this does not fluctuate because it is fluctuations are frozen, I'm left only with the gradient of theta, and I have a kinetic energy term now, which is h bar square over 2m, the density times the gradient of the phase square d2r. And this is the energy which is relevant for describing a Bose gas at low temperature or high phase space density, gradient of phase. And I would like to emphasize that this type of energy, where the energy depends only on the gradient of the phase of the field, is typical of a superfluid. What I see that the energy which is relevant in this system is the energy that I need to twist the phase. Okay, at zero temperature, the phase is uniform, and the relevant energy in the system, the relevant excitation, are excitation we are trying to twist the phase. And when you have such an energy which is relevant for the system, it's relatively easy to understand that this corresponds to a superfluid system. And the best way to understand that is to think of a good test of superfluidity, which is a so-called rotating bucket experiment. What is this experiment? The rotating bucket experiment is just to put your system 2D or 3D in a bucket and rotate the bucket and see whether, if you rotate the bucket at a uniform speed, whether the fluid which is inside the bucket will rotate together with the fluid or will stay at rest in the laboratory frame. And to compare the two possibilities, either the fluid stays at rest or the fluid rotates with the bucket, you have to think of what happens if the fluid rotates. If the fluid rotates, it means that the fluid in the lab frame, which is supposed to be an inertial frame, will acquire a non-zero phase as it rotates. It corresponds to twisted boundary condition for those of you who are doing numerical simulation. A superfluid which is at rest in a rotating frame is a superfluid which, in the lab frame, which is inertial, has some twisted boundary condition, the twist being proportional to the rotation frequency. So saying that we have an energy like that means that it costs some energy to twist the boundary condition. It takes some energy to put the superfluid in motion, and therefore, if the rotation of the bucket is small enough, the superfluid will prefer to stay at rest in the lab frame. It will cost less energy than to twist the boundary condition. So what I have done implicitly here by neglecting density fluctuation and writing my energy like that is I have said that I'm actually dealing with a superfluid, okay, with a superfluid density, which for the moment is rho. Okay? So it's a bit subtle here, but so I wanted to say it explicitly. But this corresponds to a real experiment. This twisted boundary condition that you use in numerical simulation corresponds to the experiment of rotating the bucket in which your fluid is. Any questions at this stage? No? You don't see any? Okay, so let me continue. So let's deal with this phase fluctuation, and now I would say the algebra will be relatively simple. It will be very close to what we have done for the crystal of Mr. Pyers in the first hour this morning. I will suppose that the variation of the phase are relatively soft. This theta of r fluctuates on the sample, but I assume that I don't have any phase defect for the moment, no vortices. A vortex is a phase defect which is very localized, since I told you yesterday, and I will say it later, the phase around the vortex rotates by 2 pi, irrespective of the size of the contour I take around the vortex. So vortex is a very strong phase defect. So let's neglect for the moment the vortices. I suppose that the phase varies gently over the sample. So I assume that I can Fourier expand my phase, theta, like with Fourier components which are labeled as CQ here. At thermal equilibrium, I know that the CQ modulus square will be proportional to KT, the same algebra as the one I did this morning for the vibration of the crystal. And therefore, exactly like when I calculated this morning the variance of uj minus u0 in the crystal, here if I calculate the variance of the phase theta of r minus theta of 0 in my Bose gas, that is, I'm comparing the phase that I have here and the phase that I have there, and I'm looking at how the difference between these two phases fluctuate, I will get something which, I'm not redoing the algebra, but it's really the same, will vary like the log of the distance r divided by a length scale, which is the thermal wavelength, again, which is written on this board. So here we are simply recovering the result by Pyers. And the factor in front of the log, which is important, is simply 2 over the phase space density. Okay? So I'm skipping some algebra, but nothing mysterious in this algebra. And now, let's ask ourselves, what does it mean for the order parameter of the system? The order parameter of a Bose gas, Emmanuel has told us this morning again, is simply the wave function of the psi that I'm taking. So what does it mean for the one-body Collins function, if you want, G1, this psi of r, psi star of 0? How does it vary with r if the phase of this varies like this? So I want to calculate rho 0. I have frozen the density fluctuation, so the density is uniform in the system, and I'm left only with the fluctuation of the phase. So I have to calculate the thermal average of e to the I, theta of r minus theta of 0. And there, because the theta of r is a sum of Gaussian fields, the CQ which is here, I can use a well-known result for Gaussian field, which is that the average of e to the I u, where u is a Gaussian variable, is simply the exponential of minus the variance of u, average of u squared, divided by 2. So I have to take now the exponential, when I want to calculate this, I want to take the exponential of this 2 over d times the logarithm. Okay? So what does it give, the exponential of a log? It gives, of course, the function itself with some power, and the power will be this 2 over d, which is here, divided by the 1 half, which is appearing here. So it will be 1 over d. So this is what I have written here. The one-body correlation function calculated from this formula is equal to 1 over r to the power alpha, where alpha is equal to 1 over d, the phase space density. Okay? So what we get here is a result which is notably different from what we had for the ideal Bose gas. For the ideal Bose gas, I remind you that I told you that G1 is always exponentially decreasing with distance. Here, because I have interactions, because these interactions have frozen the density fluctuation and I'm left only with phase fluctuation, I have a decay of G1, which is much smoother, which is algebraic, and this is why people speak about quasi-long-range order. And so here on this graph, I'm comparing typical situation. If I take a phase-phase density of 10, typical of what we can achieve in a laboratory with cold atoms, if I plot this G1 function with respect to the distance, R divided by the thermal wavelengths, lambda T, so typical thermal wavelengths when you are at a temperature on the order of 10 to 100 nanokelvin is a fraction of micrometer. So here I'm looking over distances of typically 100 micrometers, which again corresponds to what we can do experimentally. Here you have the result for the ideal gas. This is this exponential decrease that we'd seen this morning. And this is the algebraic decay that we get for the interacting gas. So this is still a result which is compatible with the Mermin-Wagner theorem. G1 still tends to zero when R tends to infinity. But as you see, it tends to zero very, very slowly. You have to go very, very far in order to see G1 equal to zero. So for any practical purpose, actually, you will see some phase currents between the edge of your sample and the center. Any question at this stage? Don't be shy. Excuse me? I use plane wave, exactly. So if I come back here, I have used plane wave to expand the phase. Yes. So exactly, yes. Here, this is valid only, as I said, soft variation of the phase, no vortices, exactly. When the vortices are here, this type of expansion is not valid anymore, and we will have to, then we will lose the algebraic decay. As soon as vortices, at least three vortices can be present, we will lose algebraic decay, absolutely. This will be the Kosserlitz-Sauerless transition. But for the moment, I have low temperature, and at low temperature, we will see later tomorrow that it's reasonable to assume that there are no free vortex in the sample. And since there are no free vortex, this expansion of the phase is legitimate. Yes, exactly. Yes? Ah, good point. Yes, yes, that's true. The interaction is hidden somewhere, yes. I will have a slide on that later, but I'm not sure it will answer fully your question. You need interaction to freeze the density fluctuation, of course, but once you have frozen them, as you see, the interaction energy is constant. The G tilde is here, I mean, it enters into the energy, but it's a threshold for the energy, I mean, it's a constant, and does not enter anymore as a function here. And so there are some universality aspects in this 2D Bose fluid because in precisely of your remark. Yes, that's a very good point. Yes, yes, for the interaction, yes, yes, absolutely, yes, yes. Interactions in 2D, when you want to describe really in a quantum way, are a bit complicated because you have some logs, again, you have seen many logs already, but there are some logs which appear in the scattering amplitude and so on. So at the class, I'm indeed working a single vertex within classical field analysis, yes. So this is a remark maybe which will be related to the question that you had just 1 minute ago about where are the interactions hidden. So in what I've said, they are completely, completely hidden. Actually, if you want to put them back in a heuristic way, you should come back to the formula I gave you when I gave you this expression for the kinetic energy as a function of the gradient of the phase theta. This expression, when you write it like that, assumes that the whole gas is superfluid, in the sense that when I twist my boundary condition, I'm saying that the energy that it costs is directly proportional to the density of the whole gas. This is a bit too much idealized, in the sense that I've used for this a classical field approach. I have assumed that my density fluctuations are frozen, and all these assumptions are valid only at a relatively large distance scale, larger than typically either the healing lengths associated with interaction or the thermal wavelengths. So what people do usually in order to account for this, the fact that this is really a Hamiltonian which is valid only for large distance but not valid for at short distance or for large wave vector, they take into account the physics at short distance in a heuristic way by saying, let's not put here rho, but let's put the superfluid density rho s, which is a phenomenological density at this stage, but which is a quantity which is smaller than rho, and this is a way to absorb here all the short distance physics in this rho s and to concentrate on the long distance physics. So now, back to your question, where are the interactions? The interactions actually are contained in the fact that I want to replace rho by rho s in order to put all the short distance physics under the carpet, but still remember that it's present. And the rho s will not always be the same, depending on the strength of the interaction. Rho s, if the interactions are very strong, rho s is very close to rho, whereas if the interactions are weak, rho s will be notably reduced with respect to rho. Okay, so this is, I mean, it's not a precise answer, but it tells you a way to recover some effect of interactions. Exactly, this is exactly a renormalization, absolutely, yes. So just a teaser for tomorrow, as has been noticed, my plane wave expansion is valid only in the absence of vortices. So the question I would like to show very briefly here is what happens when density fluctuation becomes significant? And what is the biggest density fluctuation that can occur? It's when the fluctuation is so large that the density becomes zero at a given point. Okay, when I have zeros of the classical field, psi, then I have a big density fluctuation because the density goes from its bulk value to zero. It cannot go beyond zero. Anyway, it has to be positive. So I just want here, I will address vortices tomorrow, but I just want here to tell you what is the zero of a classical field and convince you that vortices immediately show up when you look at the big density fluctuation and the zeros of the field. So the classical field psi of xy, as I said, is a complex field. Okay, so it has a real part and an imaginary part. Saying that I take a zero of this classical field means that the real part has to be zero and the imaginary part has to be zero. So let's look at what it means. So if I take the real part, the real part is a real quantity by definition, so it can be positive in some position of space and it can be negative in other position of space, and it will be zero along a line which will fluctuate in time because of thermal fluctuation. If I take the imaginary part, same thing, it will be zero along a line and it may be negative, say, on the left and positive on the right. And the zero of the field is a place where both the real part and the imaginary part are zero. So I have to take these two lines, the line where the real part is zero in red, the line where the imaginary part is zero in blue, and at the intersection of these two lines, I have a place where the density is zero because both real and imaginary part are zero. Now let's look at the phase around this. In this place here, the real part is positive and the imaginary part is positive. So if I plot the phase on a trigonometric circle, I have a phase which is somewhere in this quadrant here, okay? The first quadrant. Both real and imaginary part are positive. If I go here, now here, the imaginary part has become negative, but the real part is still positive. So my phase is here. Now my phase in this part, both real and imaginary are negative. So my phase is here on the trigonometric circle, and now it's here. And now you immediately see that when you rotate around this point, you get a vortex. That is, you have a phase winding of 2 pi. So it is plus 2 pi in this case. It would be minus 2 pi if I had reversed what is the region of positive and negative here. But taking into account big density fluctuation means taking into account the zero of the field, and the zero of the field, a simple zero, is simply a vortex in this context. So vortices naturally will show up when we look at big density fluctuations. Is that okay? And just to continue with that, again, to finish the teaser for tomorrow, why are vortices going to change the picture of having a superfluid or having quasi-long-range order in the phase? So let's suppose that I have no density fluctuation. So if I have no big density fluctuation, no vortices. So I have two points A and B, and between these two points A and B, there exists some weak coherence in phase, this quasi-long range order between A and B, which will, as we see, will vary in like a power law with the distance between A and B. Suppose now that vortices can be present. That is, I can have some randomly, I can put one vortex somewhere between A and B. So a vortex, as I said, is a zero of the density. So here I have put one vortex. What does it mean for the phase of the wave function? It means that if here the phase was phi, putting a vortex in between, because the phase of the associated to the vortex rotates by 2 pi around it, it means that the phase phi will become phi plus pi. So putting vortices randomly between two points will completely scramble the phase relation between these two points, because the phase can jump between phi and phi plus pi if the vortex is just put on the segment which is between these two points, and actually it will fluctuate between phi and nothing and anything else, if the vortex is not strictly on the line. So as soon as I have isolated vortices with the density rho v, I expect that I will have no phase ordering on a distance which is typically the intervortex distance, because if I take any two points separated by this distance, I have one chance out of two to have one vortex in the middle. So vortices are really something bad if you want to maintain long-range or quasi-long-range coherence. Okay? So that's why it's important to understand that I have neglected them so far, and when I will put them, all the conclusion will be changed. Is okay? No protest? Yes. Yes. Yes, this is all related to topological defects. So you're right. I mean, there is a kind of unique picture, grand picture for that, yes. Here, the vortices are objects that you can see immediately without having single atom resolution. So it's a difference with respect to what Emmanuel was discussing, where he was addressing single excitation with single particle, a hole or a doublon was a single particle effect. Here, a vortex may involve thousands of particles. The number of particles that are missing in the vortex core can be relatively big. But you're right. I mean, seeing from a sufficient large distance, the two phenomena looks very much the same. It's physics of topological defects and phase transition related to that. Yes. No more comment? Okay. So I don't think I want to go, yes, I don't think I want to go further now on the analysis of the classical field. Tomorrow we will discuss vortices and really the BKT transition, and I will give you some examples with real atoms, how this can be addressed. In the remaining 20 minutes, I would rather like to come back to the ideal gas and show you some particularity of the ideal gas that you may find in the literature. So I wanted to show them so that you wouldn't be surprised if you see them in the books. And also, since it is the end of the two-hour lecture, I wanted something relatively simple to finish the lecture. Okay, so I want to discuss back to ideal Bose gas, to a harmonically trapped system, and discuss this Bose-Einstein condensate of photons that was found first in the group of Martin Weitz in Bonn, and which has been seen now in several groups. So, for the moment, I have discussed only my 2D Bose gas in a uniform box in the XY plane. Let's suppose now that we have, in the XY plane, a harmonic potential. You remember, I have a harmonic potential along Z to confine the particle, but now I add another harmonic potential in the XY plane, much, much softer. I don't want the particle to accumulate only in the ground state of this harmonic potential, but I have a harmonic confinement in the XY plane. Now, what is known is that you recover Bose-Einstein condensation in this case, even in the thermodynamic limit, although you are in 2D. But it's not a uniform system, so it's not a violation of Mermin-Wagner theorem. And the way to understand this is to look again at the convergence of the integral I have written this morning, which I remind you what it is. It's the Bose law here Bose-Einstein law in the denominator and the density of state in the numerator. And I told you this morning that if I take a uniform 2D system, the density of state was constant, and because it was constant, this integral was not converging. But now if you take not a uniform system in 2D, but you take a harmonic oscillator, the density of state here is proportional to E. And this is relatively easy to understand. If you take a 2D harmonic oscillator, I can always look at the eigenstate of this 2D harmonic oscillator. I'm looking at the eigenstate along X and the eigenstate along Y. And so an eigenstate of the full motion in 2D requires the knowledge of both NX and NY, the degree of excitation of the X oscillator and Y excitation. And therefore, if you look at the eigenstates in energy, this is what you get. The ground state is non-degenerate, corresponds to the N equals zero both for X and Y. The first excited state is degenerate twice because you can excite X and leave Y in the ground state, or you can excite Y and leave X in the excited state by one quantum. Then the second excited state is degenerate three times, four times, and so on. So you see that the degeneracy increase with the energy and decrease linearly, 1, 2, 3, 4. So this gives you, if you take a kind of thermodynamic limit, D of E proportional to E, and then the integral converges, which means that if you take a harmonic potential in 2D, you have in the thermodynamic limit, which corresponds to going to a very, very low oscillation frequency in the XY plane, you have an upper bound on the number of atoms you can put in all excited states, which survive to the thermodynamic limit, which is simply pi squared over 6 times kbt over h bar omega to the square. So it seems that actually, as soon as you put a harmonic potential, you recover Bose-Einstein condensation in 2D like you had in 3D. Actually, this is not true. This condensate that you get in 2D in a harmonic potential is singular. And a good way to see its singularity is to try to calculate the density at the center of the harmonic potential. And in order to do that, a simple way to do that is to take again the Bose-Einstein law and take a semi-classical version of this Bose-Einstein law. That is, when you have the energy here, you replace it by the sum of kinetic P squared over 2m plus potential energy, treating P and R as classical variables. So this semi-classical approximation, which is valid when temperature is large compared to h bar omega, the quantum of oscillation in the xy plane, this semi-classical approximation allows you to write a kind of phase space density for your system. Okay? And now, since you look for Bose-Einstein condensation, you take the limit of the chemical potential mu tending to zero, you integrate over the momentum to get the density, rho of r, and you get this expression for the density. You can do all the algebra, it's analytic. You get a log of 1 minus a Gaussian function of r. This is how the density varies in the trap when you have a Bose condensate. And you see that when you go to the trap center, you can again linearize the exponential, and you get that rho of r varies like minus log of r square. And so this is a quantity which is diverging in r equals 0. And this is why I said that this condensate is singular. You get indeed a Bose-Einstein condensation, but in the thermodynamic limit, this Bose-Einstein condensation corresponds to an infinite density in zero. It's still okay because even though the density is infinite, when you take the integral of the density to get the number of particles, you get something finite because the integral of a log, even though the log is diverging in r equals zero, the divergence is not strong enough to make the integral diverging. So there is no mathematical problem here, but there is a physical problem. An infinite density is not possible as soon as the particle interacts, even very, very small, by a small amount. So for interacting particle, this is not so relevant. But it is relevant for non-interacting particle. If I have strictly non-interacting particle, well, I can accommodate for that, at least within this semi-classical approximation. Okay? So one question is, what are the non-interacting particles that I can have at my disposal? And a good candidate for a non-interacting particle are photons. Photons, in principle, do not interact with each other, at least at low energy. And so one question that we can ask is it possible to do this experiment, a 2D Bose gas in a harmonic potential with non-interacting particles? So in order to do that, We have to solve a few problems. We have to give a mass to our photons. We have to trap them harmonically in 2D. And we have to give them a non-zero chemical potential, which, for those of you who have remember their course on blackbody radiation, is not trivial. In principle, people always say that the chemical potential for photons is zero. So how is all this possible? So let's start with giving a mass to photons. How is that possible? So the experiment that was done in Bonn in the group of Martin Weiss was done in a Fabry-Perot cavity. So Fabry-Perot cavities are just two mirrors in front of each other. And these two mirrors are very close to each other. The distance is only 1.5 micrometers, so it's just a few wavelengths of the photon. The photon that will be used will be in the range 500 nanometers, yellow photon, say, yellow or green. And you take this L here such that it's only 7 wavelengths over 2 times the index of refraction and zero. So it means that the photon actually will occupy only one, what is called longitudinal mode of the cavity. The photon will, because they are selected in this range here, they will occupy only the mode n equals 7, the longitudinal mode n equals 7. If they wanted to occupy n equals 6, they would have two low wavelengths, and if it was n equals 8, it would be a too large wavelength. So the selection in wavelengths is done by taking a very, very narrow cavity so that what is called the free spectral range of the cavity is very large, and all photons will accumulate in the same n of the cavity, n equals 7. So it's a way of freezing the longitudinal degree of motion along the cavity. So now how are these photons injected in the cavity? So the cavity is filled with a dye, which has this index of refraction n0, and you pump this dye with a laser beam. So you excite the molecule of the dye, and then the molecule fluoresces, and the fluorescence photon of these molecules should enter the mode of the cavity. So we are interested, actually, in the photons which correspond to the fluorescence of the dye molecules when they are pumped by the external laser, which is represented here. Okay, so this is the experiment. Why do these photons have a mass in 2D? Well, the answer is the following. Look at this diagram here. So I have my photons which are bouncing back and forth between these mirrors with this relation between the wave vector of the photon, kz, and the length of the cavity, such that kz is equal to 7 pi times divided by the length of the cavity L. This is for a photon which is at normal incidence on the mirror. But now, let's suppose that all photons are not at normal incidence. Some photons make a small angle with respect to the optical axis. I say small because I want to use paraxial optics, but still it's an angle which is non-zero. Then the wave vector of this photon will be kz squared, which again is quantized by this formula, plus some k perp square corresponding to the small angle of the photons. So k perp is assumed to be small compared to kz. This is a so-called paraxial approximation. So I can make an expansion of this square root here, and I get that this energy is equal to h bar c over n0 kz, 1 plus a small quantity, k perp square divided by 2 kz square. And this is exactly what I need to give a mass to a photon. I have a dispersion relation, E of k, which is now quadratic with respect to k perp. So with respect to the motion in the perpendicular direction, perpendicular to the optical axis, I have now this quadratic dispersion relation, which means that I have a mass for the photon, an effective mass. And this effective mass, you can read it from this formula, it's simply h bar n0 kz over c, and when you do the numerics, you find that it's a mass which is very, very small, which is 10 to the 5 times smaller than the mass of an electron. So we have given a mass to the photon, but it's a very, very light mass, which is good because it means that it will be easy to both condense. A light object has a very long de Broglie wavelength, so it's easy to condense. And I have also some energy offset, h bar omega 0, corresponding to the photon which have no k perp, so which are only propagating along the axis. And this is this h bar omega 0. So we have fulfilled the first item, which is to give a mass to the photon. Second item is to have a harmonic trap for the photon. Harmonic trap means I don't want the same energy if I am on axis here or if I am off axis at a distance r from the optical axis of the cavity. And this is provided because I take not plane mirror for this Fabry-Perot cavity, but curved mirror. So taking curved mirror like this means that the distance L of 0 is larger than the distance L of R. L of r, again, I can do a quadratic expansion, and L of r varies quadratically with respect to the distance. So it's L0 minus r squared divided by the radius of curvature of the mirror. And if you remember that the energy of a photon which was going straight was inversely proportional to 1 over L, now, since L itself depends on r, it means that this energy h bar omega 0 will depend on r because of this variation, quadratic variation. So I have this h bar omega 0 of r, which h bar omega 0, I remind you, it's this term, the first, the zeroth order term in the expansion with respect to k. So I have some h bar omega 0, which depends on r square. And since I have a mass for my photon, I can now derive an oscillation frequency omega, and this oscillation frequency is 40 gigahertz in this experiment. So the summary of this analysis is that thanks to this setup, I have an energy for a photon at a distance r with a wave vector k-perp, which is quadratic in k-perp and quadratic in r. This is exactly a harmonic oscillator, a 2D harmonic oscillator. So it's a nice way, and I think it's nice even for theorists because it tells you how you can achieve in the lab some Hamiltonian that you have on your paper. It's a nice way to implement a 2D harmonic oscillator out of particles which in principle have no trapping potential and no mass, okay? But by restricting to 2D, this is what you get. And so now we can see what happened in this experiment. The photons, as I said, are emitted by the fluorescence of the molecule of the dye. These molecules have plenty of vibrational level, both in the excited state and the ground state. And therefore, the photons have a distribution which corresponds to a thermal distribution with the same temperature as the temperature of the molecules. So the molecules have a temperature which is room temperature, 300 K. And indeed, when you look at the spectral distribution of the photons, so this is the signal, the fluorescent signal in terms of lambda, you see that when you pump gently the system, so these are those curves here, you see photon clouds emerging from the cavity with a distribution here, which is well described by a Bose-Einstein law with some chemical potential. I will come back to this in a moment. And the temperature, which is the temperature of the dye molecule, 300 K. And when you increase the pumping, you put more and more particles in the system by cranking up the laser which pumps the molecule of the dye, then at above a threshold, you see a peak appearing close to the energy corresponding to the ground state energy of your photon, which corresponds to a Bose-Einstein condensate of photon, accumulation of photon in the lowest mode of the cavity here. And the condensation is expected, as I told you before, when the number of photons or number of particles is proportional to kbt over h bar omega to the square. I had a pi square over 6 before. Now I have a pi square over 3 because the photons have two polarization. So I have twice as many photons as in the absence of spin. And the number is typically 60,000 in this experiment, and there is a very good agreement between theory and experiment. So just one word, here I'm giving a chemical potential to the photon because I'm using this Bose-Einstein law and I'm saying mu is non-zero and it's only when mu approaches zero that there is a condensation. Why is it that we can give a non-zero chemical potential to our photons, whereas I'm sure you have been taught in your statistical physics lecture that the chemical potential for photons is zero. Well, the reason for which the chemical potential for photons is zero in black body radiation is the following. When you study black body radiation, you have all the spectrum of light which is inside an oven, and you may have a blue photon which arrives on the wall, stick to the wall, creates excitation in the wall, and then the wall will emit two red photons. As long as you conserve energy, it's okay. So the number of photons is not conserved in such a process. You have one photon becoming, after exciting the wall and re-emission, two photons. So you have, this is what is written here. You have one photon, excitation of the wall, two photons. And therefore, when you write the balance between this process, you must have mu equal to mu because you have one can give two, and therefore mu has to be equal to zero. In the experiment that I just described, there is a conservation law for the total excitation number. That is, here in this experiment, it's in good approximation, the only process which takes place is one photon plus one molecule in the ground state give one molecule in the excited state, and vice versa, one molecule excited state give one photon plus one molecule in ground state. So we have a conservation law associated with a rotating wave approximation, and because we have a conservation law, there is a Lagrange parameter associated to this conservation law, and this is precisely the chemical potential. So We have, in this experiment, a conservation law which is not present in standard black body radiation, and this is why there is a chemical potential which is not zero. And this is why this Bose-Einstein condensation of photons could be seen. Okay, so I will take question in 1 minute, but I just summarize that the lecture will be over. So what do we seen in this first lecture? We have used the modeling of the 2D gas in terms of a classical field, and we have characterized the dynamics and the thermal equilibrium of the system. Our treatment was valid when the phase theta of r could be fully expanded in terms of plane wave. And as we have seen, all vortices have been excluded up to this point. Otherwise, the Fourier expansion would not have been valid. This has led to quasi-long-range order in the presence of interaction with G1 decaying algebraically with distance. And this alpha here is proportional to the inverse of the phase space density. So this is dramatically different from the ideal gas case. And the open question, the one I would like to address later, tomorrow, is what happens in the presence of stronger phase and density fluctuations, and how can we connect this result to the high temperature case? How can we connect this algebraic decay to the high temperature case where we know that in principle we should recover exponential decay? And this is where the BKT transition will take place. With this, I stop for today, and thank you for attention, and expect questions. Thank you.